Hello, everybody. All right. Fast approaching the end, so these get thicker. This is the May 7th Standing Committee on Health. Let's get right into it. First bill, Bill S62 by Senator Harkin, if reported, would go to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to reporting of Lyme and tick-borne disease infection after death.
Pretty self-explanatory, sets reporting standards for pathologists and coroners, et cetera, for people who pass away and have Lyme or tick-borne diseases. Any questions or comments on the bill? Seeing none, I have a motion by Senator May, seconded by Senator Mannion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Without rec? That bill moves to first reading. Next, Senate Bill 149 by Senator Janaris, if reported, would go to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to the provision of end-stage renal disease services.
This bill passed both in 21 and 22. It relates to securing vascular access for hemodialysis patients and dealing with corporate ownership of facilities that are exclusively set for such purposes. Any questions or comments on the bill? Yes, Senator Ashby.
Would this require that ambulatory surgery centers have space dedicated to this?
No.
So what it just allows them to?
It allows, and it's more specifically, so there's, for the purposes of making sure that, since dialysis is an absolutely necessary, there's people without the capacity to cleanse their blood would perish. So we've actually expanded to make sure that there's access to it, we've expanded the ability of certain corporate entities to own dialysis centers. So there's also, as attached to it, there is this would allow for those same entities to also have ambulatory centers that are set exclusively for vascular access, which is something that is another procedure on top of the dialysis, which actually helps these folks stay alive and healthy.
And avoid the hospital.
What's that?
And avoid going to the hospital.
Well, certainly avoid going to the hospital, yes. But this is just to clarify that this is that these same entities are also allowed for the operation of these facilities that are ambulatory surgery centers specifically for that purpose, for vascular access for hemodialysis patients.
Thank you.
Yep. Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, motion, Senator, motion by Senator May, seconded by Senator Myrie. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Without rec? And that bill goes to first reading. Next by Senator Myrie, Senate Bill 213B, if reported, would go to first reading.
An act to amend the Agriculture and Markets Law, the General Business Law, and the Public Health Law in relation to food and food product advertising.
Senator Myrie, would you like to regale us with tales of this fine piece of legislation?
Indeed, Mr. Chair. Thank you for putting this on the agenda. I really want to send a special thank you to the staff that has helped with this bill over 2 years. I see Maria here, Carolyn, who have helped us get this bill in the right shape. I want to note that we've made a number of amendments that I think are significant and that were a result of feedback that we heard from stakeholders. One, we removed the private right of action in this bill. We have also made clear that this is intended to help with our local farm industry to direct people to healthy eating. But the simple premise of this bill is the food industry spends billions of dollars targeting our children every single year. And the food that they market can sometimes have deleterious effects if overconsumed. What we do in this bill is beef up our false advertising laws to have special consideration for marketing that's directed at our children. We know that the science has made a connection between overconsumption of junk food and obesity. We have a robust obesity prevention program in this state. I think this is in line with that. So again, much gratitude for getting this on the agenda. Look forward to passing this on the Senate floor.
Certainly a fan of it. Any questions or comments? Senator May.
Yeah, I have a question, and it has to do with the locally grown foods. Just, I know we've talked about whole milk before, which kind of gets a bad rap and doesn't apparently contribute to obesity. I'm just wondering if that's dealt with at all in the bill.
It is, and that was part of, in our conversations with our farmers, Farm Bureau, I wanted to make clear that this bill is not intended to prevent that industry from flourishing. We actually specifically call it out in this bill to make sure that that is clear.
Thank you.
Are you recording us, sir?
Oh, I was taking a photograph.
Okay, just checking.
Oh, no, I don't do that.
I have the phone up there. Maybe taking a selfie, which, you know. All right, any other further questions or comments on the bill? Hear a motion from Senator May, seconded by, I'll second that. It's a good bill, I'm a fan of it. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
Okay, we got Rhodes, Ashby, Steck, Gallivan, and without rec, Senator Martins. And that bill goes to first reading. Next, Senate Bill 266A, if reported, would go to Finance.
An act to amend the Public Health Law, the Social Services Law, and the Family Court Act in relation to establishing the Maternal Infant Care Center's pilot program and providing for the repeal of such provisions upon expiration thereof.
We've passed this bill more than a few times, and it would, and we always, and we also have the money appropriated to actually set up these four centers across the state. So we are, it's to establish, to provide less costly and more focused care for families and infants who have different either neonatal abstinence syndromes or neonatal opioid withdrawal syndrome. And we're, again, the money is there. We've had it appropriated for the last couple of years. We have to pass the bill to get them operational, so hopefully we'll be able to do that. Any questions or comments on the bill? Yes, Senator Gallivan.
A question. Does any provision of this bill waive the requirements for the mandated reporting of child abuse by various professionals?
So there's language in here, but it is codifying current practice. So under judicial decisions, there has been a ruling that only an instance, or if child abuse is connected only to addiction, that it is not a reportable offense. And so there is language in here clarifying that in connection to reporting for participation in these centers, clarifying that if that is the only sign of abuse, their participation in these programs, that should not be reported. So if there were other signs of child abuse beyond that, that would still be a reportable offense, and the language in here clarifies that.
Okay, thank you.
Yep. I mean, part of the issue here is that we need to make sure that, you know, this definitely goes along with what there's many of us who certainly have. When you're talking about harm reduction, you're talking the notion that people who use drugs are people first, that they should be certainly treated with fairness and dignity. In this case, we want to make sure that connection continues to exist between the child and their birthing parent. These centers allow for that to be the case, and just the existence of drugs in the system by itself, as was clearly stated by Tony, Mr. Kargarabad, I should say, is not enough to say that this child has been abused. So I want to make sure that again, we have the money. We tried to get it off the ground more than a few times, so I figured, you know, hopefully we get it passed and we get it signed so we can actually get these places actually operational. Any other questions or comments on the bill?
Will these centers be
yes, Senator Martins,
distributed geographically around the state?
It's areas of prevalence.
I understand. I saw that reference, but I didn't read that to mean around the state. It could, the bulk four technically could be in the same area geographically, making it more difficult for other people to get to it, because it doesn't clarify that there's going to be one spaced, what, in Western New York, one in Central New York, and one on Long Island, one in the city. There are four. Mm-hmm. And you know, I would just like clarity to make sure that as we determine where they're going to be, there's going to be some consideration for the distance between where people are and where these centers may be, so that we try to provide as much care equally across the state as we can.
Well, I would tell you that there is, first of all, this is for the establishment of a pilot program. And I am hopeful that not only can we get this off the ground, but then establish it as a, as something that could be, that could happen in far more than four locations across the state. That's number one. Number two, it is my sense that the process, once we get the thing, you know, once we get the thing passed and hopefully signed, since again the money's already appropriated, that then the process by which we determine where they are actually would take into account need and certainly geographic balance. It would be probably something that would happen internally in the department, but something that we would be, that we as a legislature and certainly I as a sponsor of the bill would remain involved in, to make sure that there is that consideration, that they have to be in places so that as many folks can use them as need them. I don't know if there's any further clarity on that.
I said it well.
But again, it's like there's a recognition, right, that if we have only four of them, we have an enormous state. There will be a consideration of need as established in the language of the bill. But the process would be determined by the department, and hopefully there's a way to do this so that there is a geographic balance. And hopefully you'll be around to also, chime in.
Hopefully, but just one last question to piggyback on Senator Gallo.
Yes, Senator Martin.
There's only one way that a child has drugs in its system at that age, mm-hmm. right? And so we understand that there is and there should be a concern there as to how those drugs ended up manifesting themselves in the child. And I understand the sponsor's concern with regard to making sure that we're providing care. Is there anything in the bill that we provide for care for a parent or for the family unit with regard to any addiction or use of drugs that would allow for a moment where the state could actually introduce that care and that help at that time? As opposed to caring for the child and then returning the child to the family unit at a point where there may be some instability in that unit because of that drug use itself.
The language of the bill states that explicitly. Partly in reads, quote, while also providing supportive services to parents preparing to bring their infants home, unquote, which would include such services.
Required or available? That I read it to be available, not necessarily a requirement of returning the child to the family.
While also providing, this is for those paying attention from home, it is page 1, line 16 of the bill. Actually, line 14 starts. The program shall provide, more appropriate settings and cost-effective care for these infants than hospitals, while also providing support and services to parents preparing to bring their infants home. So that shall is the one that says it'll be required.
It's required to provide, not required for the parents to participate as a condition of getting the child back. If there's a concern about the child being in an environment that's unsafe, that's my concern. Mm-hmm. Again, I'm not talking about criminalizing it at this point, I'm talking about whether or not we're using this moment to require the parents to also participate in the program and not just make the program available, that it is available at their option. Okay. And again, we can have this discussion mm-hmm. afterwards, or we can talk about it, but that's my concern.
Gotcha. There's one thing more that you want to add?
Well, I was just going to say, it's typically with medical services, there's usually an offering, and it's up to individuals to make informed decisions about their care. I understand the concern that you're iterating, but it
is what we're dealing with children, we're dealing with infants, we're dealing with family units, and we're trying to facilitate, again, the care that's necessary. I think the adult has to also be responsible for a portion of this in the construct that I believe the sponsor is trying to achieve. That's just my opinion.
And so it would provide it, but it wouldn't mandate it under this language. Mm-hmm.
Any questions? Any further questions or comments on the bill? Seeing none, do I have a motion? I see a motion by Senator May, seconded by Senator Myrie. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Without rec?
Without rec.
Okay. Got Stack, Gallivan, Martins, and Rose. Ashby?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, sir. And that bill is referred to finance. Next, Senate Bill 1449 by Senator Sanders is reported would go to first reading.
An act to direct the City of New York to conduct an analysis of stormwater and groundwater issues in Southeast Queens.
Pretty self-explanatory. The areas are laid out in the bill, and this will be to establish a study and a report for groundwater in these regions in Queens. Questions are, I see Senator Martin's first, and then Senator Mack.
Yeah. We have a sole source aquifer on Long Island. Most people forget that Queens and Brooklyn are actually part of the same island.
Yes, you're not part of the mainland. We know. Speaking from the mainland, I'm just saying.
I hear you. But we do have a sole source aquifer. And so that sole source aquifer, especially the areas of Southeast Queens, have an interesting history. And its impact, not only in Queens, but also in Nassau County, is significant. Before those areas of Queens converted from relying on local water to having that water be the same that the rest of the mainland uses, which is throughout state New York, they were pumping water at a rate where they actually reduced the water table by about 10, sometimes 15 feet. Significant impacts locally, environmentally, and impacted communities far and wide in the area. In fact, when they stopped pumping, the water table adjusted and there were places like subway tunnels that were flooded, sub-basements that were flooded, because they were built at a time when the water table was actually significantly below where it is now because of all the pumping that was taking place. So I would just make a recommendation that when this study takes place, they also take into consideration those portions outside. And I'll talk to the sponsor
yes.
about that. Because it is a much larger area that will be impacted, and not just, I just don't want anyone to think that this is a local bill just to those areas of Queens. It's a much broader discussion, and there are organizations already in place in Nassau and Suffolk County, that, including the USPS, that are monitoring these things. Whatever study we have should be incorporated in that as well.
Gotcha. Senator May?
I just was curious how this ended up in the Health Committee. Seems like an environmental conservation bill. I'm just curious.
So it was dual reference. It was dual reference from, I believe, local governments.
City?
Or cities?
Yes. Okay. Except it's not.
Cities.
Except it was recommitted to us after, I guess it passed cities?
Yes, it passed cities and then it was sent to us.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Present comments? I see none. I see a motion for Senator May. Seconded by Senator Salazar. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Without rec. And yes, we'll mention it. That bill is moves to first reading. We'll certainly mention it to the sponsor as well. Yep. Perfect. All right. Next bill, Senate Bill 2079 by Senator Kavanaugh, if reported, would go to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to requiring food service establishments to permit the use of reusable beverage and food containers provided by customers.
Pretty self-explanatory, just so that you can provide beverage containers or food containers for either leftovers or for drinks that you want to have at the location, so that we try to minimize the use of single-use receptacles, so to speak. Any questions or comments on the bill?
Great, no, move it.
All right, we have a motion by Senator May, second by Senator Brute. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
All opposed.
Okay, we've got Rhodes and Steck, and without rec, Martins. All right.
Oh, I apologize, which one are we
20,
on?
We are 2079.
I apologize, I'm an A.
You sure?
Could have been an A. I'm sure.
Briefly. All right, this guy's made too. All right, so that bill moves to first reading. Next, Senate Bill 2085 by Senator Kavanaugh, if reported, will go to finance.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to the closure of hospitals or emergency or maternity departments.
And this is a bill to establish a process to process of closures for again hospitals, ERs, or maternity departments. It would determine to determine the impact on the community, reset the community fund requirement, etc. Any questions or comments on this?
A question.
Yes, Senator Galvin.
Is it the whole state or New York City only?
This is New York. This is a state. This is a statewide bill.
with a different application in New York City, in the sense that there's a different governance structure. There's some differences, right, between New York City and the rest of the state?
There's certain.
I mean, as far as what this bill requires.
I think there's like notification to local elected officials, and it mentions like city council member.
Well, I guess you're saying about as far as the community component, like the community advisory.
Well, yeah, in part, and then you notify the city council. Does the bill provide for, let's just say, in the rural areas, you don't have cities, and a hospital is located within a town or a village? Does it automatically apply, or that's written right into it?
So, if you're referring to the notification, it's the state senator, assembly member representing the area where the facility is located, the city or county department of health, where applicable, and the community board or city council member representing the area where the facility is located. So in more rural settings where you don't necessarily have like the city council or community board necessarily, you still have the state senator, state assembly member,
and the county health officials.
I'm just wondering though, should there be an amendment to specifically say, or if located in a town or a village, then that governing body specifically?
Tell you what,
I'm just curious.
No, I got you. I certainly acknowledge the concern. We will touch base with the sponsor. It is likely, it would be my guess, and maybe some of the central staff could actually help us with this, but it would be my guess that in similar instances that might already exist in state law, this language might already exist and be sufficient to cover.
Understood.
To cover localities that are different, because obviously, you know, the city of New York is certainly different from, you know, the town of, pick your town or village or what have you. I figured that, would that be correct, that there's already existing versions of language that cover all this? Is that sufficient for you, sir?
Yeah, but I'll be without rec at this time. We'll do a little bit more homework on it.
That
would be my only concern. I mean, supportive of a process in place. We just want to make sure that the application is to everybody across the state.
Duly noted. Any other questions or comments on the bill? Seeing none, do I have a motion? I have a motion for Senator Myrie, seconded by Senator Brooke. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? And without rec?
Without rec.
All right. Stack Ashby Gallivan, right?
Yes, sir.
As well as Martins and Rhodes. And that bill is reported to Finance. All right. Next bill, Senate Bill 2122A by this dude, and it will be reported to Finance.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to establishing the Donor Conceived Person Protection Act.
Senator Gallivan, so tell us about your bill.
yes, thank you, Chairman. About 2 years ago, a 27-year-old who lived in our district died of an accidental overdose. So many of us have dealt with families like that. A couple months later, though, the parents came to me, and it turns out what they had learned after he died was that this individual was donor conceived. The parents had fertility issues. They ultimately were referred to a clinic, and this boy was born. Was born and known as a donor conceived person. And early on, he started having problems, and it turns out that he ultimately was diagnosed with schizophrenia, which is a hereditary, or can be hereditary or genetic. And he just really had over half his life. It was just terrible. In and out of treatment, again, a similar story, but in and out of treatment and in a lot of pain for a lot of years. And so first the parents told me that part of the story, and then they told me the next part, that was what they had since found out, and I don't know exactly how, was that this particular donor was a college student at the time and had donated sperm on multiple occasions and ultimately had a significant number of offspring. And come to find out, there was at least 11 or 12 people that were in different places of the country that were donor conceived by the same donor that all had the same history: schizophrenia, overdose, and all of these problems. And And I asked the parents, well, didn't you know his medical record and all this? And they said, well, yeah, they told us, but he lied. He just said he was healthy, didn't disclose things. And so two things. So first, it rips your heart out. That was my reaction. And second, you say, like, how can this be? So there's about, there can be as many as 60,000 people a year annually that are donor conceived and born in that manner, conceived in that particular manner. And the industry is largely unregulated. And so this bill tries to address that in two ways. The first part is simply that it requires the donor to provide accurate medical information and provide the name of the medical professionals that treated him or her in the preceding 5 years. And then it requires the cryobank or clinic to verify that information. That's the first part. The second part is the second part mirrors the adoptee laws now, the rights for adoptees, that ultimately they can get access to that information for medical purposes. So my wife, for instance, has a gene that makes a woman more susceptible, it could be a man as well, but more susceptible to certain types of cancer. And so the good thing about us knowing that is our kids can be tested and so on the line. Going back to this family, had they known at the time, they wouldn't have said, no, we're not going to do this. They would have been able to avail themselves of early treatment and ultimately be able to prevent something like this from happening. So anyway, that's how this came about. That's what this bill does. Like Senator Myrie spoke about his bill, bill has been about 2 years in the making. It's gone through a number of iterations with various groups. But Nico from my office, Tony and Jorge really spent a lot of time. Senator Rivera was involved in putting this together to ultimately end up with this product. So that's what the bill is. It's just shocking to me that the industry is largely regulated. Of course, we can't regulate the rest of the country, but we can regulate anything connected to this if it takes place in New York State. So that's what the bill does. And again, thanks to the people involved and the chairman for helping to advance this.
And a notion that a Republican would actually be so pro-regulation was a little bit stunning to me at first. But in all seriousness, I'm glad that we're able to get to a version that I think works and that both sets up what information is available, who's responsible for keeping it, and I'm hoping that we can actually do something with it. Do you have any questions or comments? Senator May.
I was just going to move the bill.
Oh, any other questions or comments?
I'll second.
Senator Brewer?
I'm
going to get your stack. I'm going to get you.
A quick question. And I would think Senator Galvin, this is something that has been on our minds a lot and has happened locally as well. You mentioned that there are repercussions through this bill, both for the donor and for the company handling it. Is that true? And what are those for not?
Oh, ask Nico. I have focused so much on the problem, I'm having a hard time answering that. Certainly, so for the company itself, the Department of Health regulates it in the sense that they provide a license, so they could lose that, but...
Yeah.
So, just to chime in, so this, like, it would be a violation of public health law as well, which has standard penalties lined out into it. So it depends on if it's like a willful violation, if it's the first violation, secondary violations, penalties increase. So this would be... any violation of this would be a violation of public health law. And so I think the initial penalty is up to $2,000.
On the individual or on the company?
It could be on, it could potentially be on either. If the individual was found to be intentionally falsifying information, it could, and it's an up to amount. It's not like a required amount.
So we create no new penalties?
No new penalties.
It's built apply what exists.
Correct.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I
have a question.
Yeah, Senator Marks.
Does there have to be a demonstrated medical need to get access to those records? Or will you be able to track down your biological parents?
Well,
as a result, perhaps even those people who do not want to be identified and create a link for people who may not want it. Is it just for purposes of providing medical certainty and continuity so that there's an opportunity?
So two things. Anonymity for the donor still exists. It's accessing, once the individual turns 18 years old, they can access the records, but not the identity. And later on, if if they can also ask, can we get updated information?
On medical.
Yes, and then it would be, it would be upon the clinic to try to reach out to the donor if they can locate them, and that would, that could be challenging, but the purpose is medical, right? So they can deal with, the best way I can describe it is what adoptees went through for so many years, and now the state provides that, and some of the language mirrors the adoptee rights, as far as the right to know part of it. But simple purpose is for medical reasons for that individual, so they know and they can get appropriate treatment and head off problems at the pass.
And for the record, I'm going to bust Nico's chops. Unless he had to really go
to the bathroom.
He
actually did have another commitment, and I said, when you have to go, you have to go, yes. And it was a pretty serious one that he had to go to.
All right. I was going to give him some guff. Anyway, any further comments or questions on the bill? Seeing none, do I have a motion? Senator Myrie, seconded by Senator Steck. Yeah, saw you, buddy.
Thank you.
All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Without rec? And that bill is reported to finance. All right, next bill, Senate Bill 2984 by Senator Kavanaugh, if reported, would go through finance.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to the closure of nursing homes.
So this is similar to an earlier bill in that it establishes a procedure for the closing of nursing homes. It obviously is different because nursing homes are different than hospitals or emergency departments, etc. But it is a closure procedure. It establishes what a closure plan needs to have, what the community involvement, etc., etc. Do you have any questions or comments on this bill? Seeing none, do I have a motion? See a motion by Senator Myrie, second by Senator May. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Without rec?
Without rec.
Okay, so without rec, we got Rhodes, Martins, Ashby, Steck, and Gallivan. And that bill is reported to finance. Next by Senator Mannion, Senate Bill 3106, if reported, would go to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to expanding the emergency medical technician recertification demonstration program throughout the state and extending the length of such recertification, and to amend Chapter 563 of the laws of 2001, amending the public health law relating to providing for an emergency technician 5-year recertification demonstration program in certain counties in relation to the effectiveness thereof.
And a partridge in a pear tree. Senator Mannion, would you like to tell us about your bill?
Christmas in May, yes. Yes. So as we have all heard, you know, the crisis as it relates to emergency medical services is great and stark. This came out of a number of conversations, including a roundtable, where there are certain counties that are allowed for the EMT recertification process to happen every 5 years, and we want to extend it to 7 years and extend it throughout the state. Some EMTs choose not to recertify because it's a little bit onerous and they take themselves out of it. But as, if there's any concerns about what they do, you know, they're practicing this, you know, their skills continuously. And when you talk to these seasoned EMTs, they say there's really, you know, the recertification process is just onerous and really a revalidation of what they do every day. So I believe that the governor in the pandemic had an automatic extension, and this, you know, outside of that, is going to expand to all counties and lengthen the time necessary for recertification. Thank you for bringing it to the committee.
Absolutely. Thank you for putting it together. Certainly a good bill. I'm a fan. Any other questions or comments on the bill? Senator Martins.
So as a condition of getting the 7-year certification, they have to show that they're putting in 130 hours a year. So in the fourth year, they hit 130. The fifth year is that they don't. They have to go back and get recertified immediately in order to continue to provide, or is that extended to 7 years? When does that requirement kick in if they don't meet the 130-hour requirement annually?
It's my understanding that they have that entire 7-year process to have that those number of hours.
130 hours in 7 years?
Oh. Of continuing training, yes, correct.
Okay. My understanding from the EMTs that I deal with every day, is that they're out several times a week. Those that are active are out almost every day. And so to the extent that they're out there performing, I mean, 130 hours over 7 years turns out to be rather a minimal amount of time.
So this isn't like on, this is a separate educational requirements, 130 hours of like continuing medical education.
So we're going to require that they have to do 130 hours over 7 years in order to extend from 3 to 7 years, but we won't know until they've actually completed the 7 years whether or not they've achieved 130 hours so they pass the parole. So we're actually extending it to 7 years as de facto. The 130 hours won't be actually verified until we hit the 7 years, and then won't be for another 7 years if it gets recertified. There's no way to test it along the way or to track whether or not the person's hitting those hours in any meaningful way.
So I think I misunderstood your question initially. So these are 130 hours of instruction.
That's what
we
just clarified.
Yeah, gotcha.
But again, if there's a requirement that they have a certain level of instruction over time, you don't know until the 7 years. They can take 0 hours and still have 7 years of service and not have completed any training requirements for those 7 years.
I don't believe that would be accurate for their initial, for you to be able to have your initial certification. That requires, there's an initial certification that's required. We're talking about recertification.
Let's say they have it today, they certify today, mm-hmm. and then they take no more training for 7 years. They're okay going out for the next 7 years without understanding that at the end of 7 years, they're no longer going to continue to provide EMT services. But there's no continuing requirement. It's only measured at the end of the 7 years.
So typically with continuing medical education requirements, it's verified upon the recertification.
It is, but it's not a 7 year period. They're much shorter periods, and you know, we do the same thing. The legal profession, the medical profession has the same thing. There are requirements, but you check in to make sure that they're actually checking boxes. 7 years is a long time. And so if we extend it from 3 to 7 years, which is what the sponsor suggested, without having any
five to seven. Currently it's
in certain counties, in other counties,
including Nassau.
Well, I understand. I've read Nassau. Trust me, I saw it. I'm just questioning the methodology. That's all.
Senator, if I may as well, within Article 30 of the Public Health Law, which is the statute that regulates EMS, the Department of Health does have regulatory authority, so a lot of the day-to-day kind of detail stuff like that is kind of governed within the regulations process. And they'll be able to, you know, they're empowered to create regulations that may require checking in before 7 years happens to see if they are up to their, you know, to see what they're doing, the process, how they're doing.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, do I have a motion? I see a motion by Senator Myrie, seconded by Senator Salazar. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Without rec? That left Senator Martins, and that bill moves to first reading. The next bill by Senator Breslin, Senate Bill 3400, if reported, would go to Finance.
An act to amend the Public Health Law and the Insurance Law in relation to utilization review program standards and in relation to pre-authorization of health care services.
So pretty self-explanatory, amends both prior authorization and utilization review process. Do we have any questions or comments on the bill? Seeing none, do I have a motion? See a motion by Senator May, seconded by Senator Myrie. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Without rec? Without rec? Oh, we were opposed?
Nay.
I'm sorry. Senator Ashby is opposed without rec. And that bill is reported to Finance. Next, also by Senator Breslin, Senator Bill 3402, if reported, would go to first reading.
An act to amend the Public Health Law and the Insurance Law in relation to providing that the failure by the utilization review agent to make a determination within a certain time period shall be deemed to be an approval of the health care services.
And that one is also pretty self-explanatory. If within a certain time period there is no response as to whether the care in question was approved or not, it will be deemed to be an approval. Do I have any questions or comments on the bill?
I'm a fan of this one personally. I see this. I see a motion by Senator May, seconded by Senator Myrie. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. Ashby, and without rec. All right. That is a bill. We'll go to first reading. Next, Senate Bill 3472, if reported, would go to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to the submission of information to the Department of Health for physician profiles.
We've passed this one in the past. I'm hoping that we can get it done. It modifies physician profile reporting, among other things, to allow for physicians to authorize someone to do the thing for them. They don't have to sit there and do it themselves. We have to actually get permission to that. That's a little crazy. But anyway, any questions or comments on the bill? Seeing none, do I have a motion? Okay, motion by Senator Myrie, seconded by Senator May. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Without rec. And that bill goes to first reading. Next, still on this, folks. We've got a couple more. Next bill, 3577, if reported, would go to finance.
An act to amend the social services law in relation to authorizing the payment of medical assistance for the provision of kidney transplants for certain residents of New York.
So currently, you, if you're an undocumented person, you can actually be a donor of a kidney, but you cannot receive one. And I think it's a little unfair. And so this bill would go towards fixing that, although the coverage for all, which we've already talked about in this committee before, and the one that these folks, these fine folks upstairs, decided not to seek federal waiver for, leaving like $400 million out of the conversation to come to the state of New York. Anyway, not that I'm salty about it at all. Anyway, that would actually cover this. So that's another reason, really. So we want to do, we also would save over $500 million in emergency Medicaid, but you know, it's neither here nor there. Any questions or comments about this bill?
Senator Gallagher. Two questions.
Yeah.
First, a federal, am I correct in thinking that a federal waiver would be required for this?
No. Go ahead, Tony.
It would likely be with state-only funds. New York has expanded several programs, including Child Health Plus, some Medicaid coverages for undocumented individuals. Typically, in those instances, it's been state-only. We haven't gotten a waiver connected to those program expansions.
And the second question, are there any estimates about how many people this would affect annually?
I don't know that we have annual estimates. There is... we could look into it and follow up with
you. Or any estimate that you may
have. There is emergency Medicaid data that we could track down about, because emergency Medicaid will cover dialysis, but it won't cover the actual organ transplant. And so we could probably extrapolate some information based on the current number of dialysis patients. Under this bill, there is a requirement that the individuals have been on dialysis for a period of at least two consecutive years.
And that actually just triggered one additional question.
Mm-hmm.
So if this bill were to pass, then the individual, the prospective recipient, would they be following just the normal procedures that anybody else would have to follow, being on a transplant list, or obviously if there's a voluntary donor for them? So they would be,
yep.
Be the same, they would fall into the same set of rules.
It's just basically expanding eligibility.
Okay.
It's not an automatic thing, but it's expanding eligibility. But as far as your concern about, or your question about the fiscal impact, I go once again.
No, my question here is people. I'm wondering how many people this will impact.
Yep.
And there is a fiscal impact, I know, but my question is people. Mm-hmm. About people.
Just particularly perplexed, not at your question, I appreciate the question. I'm perplexed at these folks upstairs. They left so much, hundreds of millions of dollars that they don't want to go get. I don't know. Anyway, again, not that I'm salty. Any further questions or comments on this bill? Senator Martins.
I saw a reference to the 2 years of dialysis.
Yes.
As a precondition, is that dialysis in state?
It doesn't specify if they could verify medical records for out of state.
The only reason I'm asking is it's important, certainly in my consideration, the contact with the state, the fact that they are state residents, that they are actually here in New York State,
yeah.
not just here in New York State to receive care, because New York State is generous that way, and the taxpayers of New York State are generous that way, but because they actually have an access here, they're living here, they're residents here, they're receiving treatment here,
right.
and then there's at least some tie to the state, so that we're not actually just opening the door to New York State being a landing spot for people who need care. I just think from a public policy standpoint, that nexus to the state is important.
Yeah, right.
So the bill does require them to be residents of the state, so it does establish that nexus there.
It doesn't explain how we verify residents. And so I was asking about the treatment, whether the treatment would be in state, because I think that would go a long way towards also establishing the nexus with the state. It says there's a reference to being a resident of the state. How do you verify that? And what kind of proof is a sponsor, would the sponsor expect to be included in such a review?
It would be my understanding that much like in any other instance that of services that are already approved by the state for undocumented individuals that require residency, that have a residency requirement, that it would be the same type of proof required to establish residency. So if there's the Department of Health, if the Department of Health already and the central staff can chime in, if there is already a requirement for residency for services that are already approved for undocumented folks with state-only money, that there is there are standards for how that's determined that already exist for those programs, and it would probably be the same one, or it would probably be a similar one, I would say, once the Department of Health would establish it.
So I guess I would just add that this is expanding Medicaid eligibility. Under Medicaid, certain undocumented populations are allowed to be covered. I don't have the details of specifically like what the application form, the intake form and process looks like as far as the particulars, how residency is verified, but it is a requirement under state Medicaid for individuals to be residents of the state, and whoever would be enrolling them, whether it's the Department of State or HRA, they would have to have procedures included in their application process to determine an individual's residency. And I don't know if anyone else wants to add.
I do appreciate that. Mm-hmm. I just, my concern is it could be as simple as an application.
Yeah, and that
definitely. They've been in the state for 2 years without any objective verification, understanding that there's going to be a significant expense on behalf of the state for these things. I just, again, am mostly my concern that there will be a nexus to the state before we go down.
Senator, if I can have a second. To apply for Medicaid, did you have to provide different proofs of residency, including things such as a pay stub with an address, a utility bill, a photo ID, a lease, a notice from a certified letter from the plan board, et cetera, showing that you live at the residence?
So if we pass the bill, hopefully we will, it gets signed into law, then the requirement would need to be established by the Department of Health, which would probably be the same requirement that exists already for other services.
Chairman, I appreciate two different things.
Yep.
One is applying for Medicaid, qualifying for Medicaid. Two is the 2-year requirement for dialysis, showing a 2-year span. I'm not entirely sure that the application for Medicaid requires any kind of time frame within which they have to apply. They just have to be a resident of New York State. So I get it. I understand. You can follow up afterwards.
Yeah.
That's my concern.
And what I would say is, if the person can prove that they're a resident now, then they would have the ability, if this were to pass, and hopefully it will, that they would have the same eligibility as anybody else, which would give them the opportunity to be able to receive, hopefully, an organ that would extend their life and their quality of life. And they can prove they're a resident now. Maybe they just moved to New York in the last year and they were getting dialysis before that. They've only been receiving it now in the state of New York for a year. And if they can prove the residency, and I get your concern, but I would say that in my view, once the residency is established and once they are a New Yorker, then there's certain responsibility that we have to them, and at least providing that eligibility, providing that access, is ultimately what this is about. Because again, I'll repeat, individuals can now be donors, but they cannot be, they cannot receive donations, which seems mighty unfair to me. Any other questions or comments? All right, hearing none, do I have a motion? I have a motion for Senator Myrie, seconded by Senator Brooke. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Without rec?
Without rec.
Okay.
Without rec.
Okay. Rose, Martins, Steck, and Gallivan. Ashby?
Aye.
Thank you. And that is referred to Finance. Next, Senate Bill 3591A by Senator Breslin, if reported, would go to Finance.
An act to amend the public health law and the education law in relation to the collaborative practice medication adherence, and to amend Chapter 21 of the laws of 2011, amending the education law relating to authorizing pharmacists to perform collaborative drug therapy management with physicians in certain settings, in relation to making the provisions of such chapter permanent.
Another long title. This is for establishing voluntarily a collaborative practice medication adherence protocol between pharmacists, doctors, and patients. It establishes what a pharmacist can do. It doesn't change the scope of practice. It just says they can enter into this collaborative arrangement. And we've passed it before in the Senate. Hopefully, we can get it done this year. Any questions or comments on this bill? Seeing none, do I have a motion? See Senator Salazar, seconded by Senator Myrie. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Without rec. And that bill is moved to Finance. Next, by Senator Fernandez, Senate Bill 4513, if reported, would go to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to preserving access to affordable drugs.
So there is a practice that some folks engage in, which is known as pay for delay, in which pharmaceutical companies might make certain arrangements with companies that are producers of generic drugs for so that they can squeeze a little bit more out of that out of drugs that are used what's the word that I'm looking for? Thank you. Patented drugs that are produced by that pharmaceutical company, and in this case, this would ban such arrangements in the state of New York. Do I have any questions or comments on the bill? Yes, Senator Brooke.
I just wanted to thank you, Chair, for bringing this bill back to committee, and to Senator Fernandez for putting it forth. I just want to reiterate, if people understand that companies that come up with these, pharmaceutical companies that come up with these patents, get 20 years, right? 20 years on the market to be the only ones with these drugs, medications. That's ton of time to rack up the profits to make as much money as they want back, and the idea that this practice exists, that you can squeeze out even more profits by jacking up prices for individuals who need, in some cases, life-saving or life-sustaining medications, is so appalling to me. And so at least here in New York, I think this is absolutely the right way to go, and I think all of us have heard so many stories from our constituents about the fact that not only are healthcare costs completely skyrocketing, unable to be sustained for most people, but the price of medications, and to think that there are, you know, pharmaceutical CEOs and executives who wouldn't think twice about this, living in, I don't know where rich people live, lots of mansions all over the world, and then you've got mom and dads who can barely afford medication for their kids. So I think this is absolutely in line with the values of our state, and I think it will end up helping a lot of our residents.
So unless there's any other questions or comments, that certainly sounds like she is moving the bill. And seconded by Senator Salazar. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? We got Steck opposed. Without rec? Ashby, Martins. And that bill goes to first reading. Next, by Senator Jackson, for Bill 4950, if reported, would go to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to the employment of persons to function as infection preventionists in certain general hospitals.
This just establishes the standard for the profession of infection preventionists. Doesn't necessarily create a new scope of practice, it just kind of standardizes the profession. Do I have any questions or comments on the bill? Seeing none, do I have a motion? See a motion for Senator Salazar, seconded by Senator May. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Without rec?
Without rec.
Okay, without rec, Gallivan and Steck, and Ashby and Martins. And that bill goes to first reading. Next, almost done, folks. Next bill, 5329 by Senator Harkin, if reported, would go to finance.
An act to amend the public health law and the social services law in relation to the functions of the Medicaid Inspector General with respect to audit and review of medical assistance program funds and requiring notice of certain investigations.
So this bill was passed and vetoed. It was passed in 2021, passed in 2022, and vetoed in 2022. This is an amended version of the bill, but still changes parameters for how OMIG operates, and the sponsor posits that it would protect providers if passed in the current format, the current way it's currently written. Do I have any questions or comments on the bill? Seeing none, I see a motion by Senator Mannion, seconded by Senator Brook. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Without rec? And that bill is reported to finance. Next, Senate Bill 6123, if reported, would go to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to the submission of claims for services provided by home care agencies.
Well, let's just say that there's been somewhat questionable, some might say, actions by certain vendors that relate to how home care agencies get paid. And so this would change a little bit of the standards for processing of claims to avert somewhat, again, questionable actions by certain vendors. Any questions or comments? I see Senator May, seconded by Senator Mannion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Without rec?
Without rec.
Okay. Got Martins, Ashby, Steck, and Gallivan. And that bill goes to first reading. Next, another bill by Senator Mannion, and it is 6351. If reported, would go to French Mannion. It would go to finance.
An act to amend the public health law and the insurance law in relation to a premium reduction for physicians, nurses, and other staff who complete a risk management strategies course relating to emergency department visits for individuals with a developmental or intellectual disability.
Merci, Emmanuel. S'il vous plaît.
Filet mignon, I think you said that. I appreciate that unfortunate nickname. So I appreciate the chair bringing this, and this would be a voluntary course that individuals could take for a premium reduction for, it's regarding their insurance. It's actually a course that's already being developed by the Developmental Disabilities Planning Council, and is. I'm sure people are aware, sometimes in an unfamiliar setting and a dramatic setting, that an emergency room can be. Individuals with disabilities sometimes find that more challenging. We want to make sure that our medical practitioners are trained and receive a benefit for having that training in the setting.
You're here. Any questions or comments on the bill? Say none. I see it's moved by Senator May, seconded by, I'll second that bill. And that all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Without rec?
Without rec.
Okay. Yeah. Steck and Gallivan without rec. And Rhodes. And that bill goes to finance. Next, Senate Bill 6408A, if reported, would go to finance.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to requiring chain restaurants to label menu items that have a high content of added sugars.
So this is, again, it's pretty self-explanatory. If you have chain restaurants, that's more than 15 locations nationwide. This will be a standard, this will be a requirement for you to tell us where you have added sugars in your food items. Any questions or comments on the bill? I was hoping that Myrie would be here, because it kind of like goes along with the type of stuff we wanted to do earlier. But seeing none, do I have a motion? I see Senator Salazar, seconded by Senator Brook. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. Rhodes, Ashby, Steck. Excuse me. Gallivan,
yes, sir.
Nay. All right. Without rec? we got Rick Martins, and that bill goes to Finance. Next, Senate Bill 6542, if reported, would go to Finance.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to new birth screening for glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency.
You might remember that phrase because we practiced it last year in the class, glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase. And we practiced it, and we passed it, and there was a chapter amendment, and the folks upstairs messed it up. So this is to fix what the chapter amendment broke. And do I have any questions or comments on this bill? Seeing none, do I have a motion? I see Senator Mannion, seconded by Senator Brook. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Without rec. And that bill moves to Finance. Next bill, 6668, if reported, would go to Finance. Oh, I'm sorry. What was that?
6668
would go to first. We'll go to first read. Thank you.
An act to amend the social services law and the correction law in relation to presumptive eligibility for medical assistance benefits of individuals leaving incarceration.
There's a similar bill, I guess last week or the week before that, but this one would go a little farther and it would be presumptive eligibility for folks who are being released for Medicaid. Do I have any questions or comments on the bill? Seeing none, do I have a motion? Motion by Senator Brooks, seconded by Senator Salazar. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
Okay, so Gallivan, Speck, and Rhodes without rec, Ashby and Martins, and that bill goes to first reading. Next bill, 6690, if reported, would go to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to permitting a close friend to make an anatomical gift of a descendant's body.
This obviously has, there's a hierarchy here for who gets to make those, what happened? Okay. There's a hierarchy here for the folks who have the authority to make these determinations and decisions regarding posthumous anatomical gifts. And this would add close friends, but they would be at the end, way after family and everything else. Any questions or comments on the bill? Seeing none, do I have a motion? I see a motion by Senator May, seconded by Senator Brook. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Without rec? Without rec, Rose and Martins. That bill goes to first reading. Next bill, 6733, if reported, would go to Finance.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to expanding health care services provided by telehealth and to amend Part B of Chapter 57 of the laws of 2022, amending the public health law and the insurance law relating to reimbursement for commercial and Medicaid services provided via telehealth in relation to the effectiveness thereof.
This is something that we would be a continuation of something that we did during the pandemic related to providing pay parity for telehealth services and FQACs. We tried to get it in the budget, did not make it, but hopefully we can get it done as a standalone piece of legislation. Do I have any comments or questions on the bill? Senator Mannion. You're moving it, and it's moving by Senator Mannion, seconded by Senator Brook. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Without rec. And that bill is reported to Finance. Can you believe it, folks? We're coming to the end one, the last one. Senate Bill 6749A, if reported, would go to first reading.
An act to amend the public health law in relation to establishing a community-based paramedicine demonstration program and providing for the repeal of such provisions upon expiration thereof.
So this is something that it's pretty self-explanatory, would extend it for 5 years. It currently is set to expire.
It's with the expiration of the emergency, the executive order for public health emergency.
Gotcha. So we want to extend that for 5 years. Do you have any questions or comments on the bill? None, do I have a motion? Motion by Senator May, seconded by Senator Salazar. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Without rec? All right. We got a long one next week, so get ready for that one too. Meeting adjourned.